I'm Patrick Pacheco. Coming up on Theater All the Moving Parts, a chat with Tony-nominated actor Tovah Feldshuh about her new memoir, Lilyville. Hello, and welcome to this virtual episode of Theater, All the Moving Parts. Joining us is the protean Tony-nominated actor we know and love as Tovah Feldshuh. But to her family, she was first Terry Sue. The two worlds come together in Lilyville, her new memoir. Welcome, Tovah.
Wonderful to be here with you, Patrick.
It's good to see you again. The subtitle of your book, Tovah, is Mother, Daughter, and Other Roles I've Played. How did you come up with that concept?
Well, when I started to write this memoir, my publisher, Hachette, I'm sure, was expecting many sparkling opening nights, backstage stories, toward love affairs, rigorous rehearsals. And instead, I convinced them happily to let me focus on the greatest, the longest, and the most profound role of my career, which is as Lillian Kaplan Feldshuh's daughter, a role I never auditioned for. But I'm a first-time author. I've written monologues. I've written my one-woman shows with the help of other wonderful writers. And I thought I'd better put this book, structure it, in the form I know best, which is as a theater piece. So the memoir, there's the gallery. The memoir is structured in three acts with two intermissions and even has what's called, we don't call it this in the book, in-ones. In-ones came from vaudeville, Patrick, as you know, where the actor would go down into the front curtain of the stage while they were changing the scenery behind him, and they would do certain palate cleansers, certain jokes. We see it still in our Broadway musicals where the actors go way downstage, curtains close, and behind them, they change from one set of My Fair Lady to another. So my in-ones in the book have to do with Tovah-isms, my view of life, mostly Lily-isms, and then some palate cleansers about my career and the wonderful roles I have been gifted with for the 50 years I have been a professional actor. In 1971, I arrived at the Guthrie and got my equity card this month to go on the stage as a spear carrier and journeyman at the Guthrie Theater.
Mazel tov.
Thank you.
The book is filled with a deep devotion to Jewish tradition and Jewish ritual. Did this influence why you changed your name from Terry Sue to Tovah?
Wonderful question. No. What influenced my name change is I fell in love with Michael Fairchild, who was up at Wesleyan. I have now reconnected, incidentally, through this book with Michael. And
was an uber wasp, right?
Uber schmuber fabulous. He was marvelous, artistic. He's a great photographer. We fell in love. And he was the one at Theater by the Sea in Matunuck, Rhode Island. We were forehead to forehead. I had my first leading ingenue roles in a non-equity house, and I had a huge salary. It went from $30 to $40 a week. Don't tell anyone. That's what Tommy Brentwood. Dear Terry, do not tell anyone I'm giving you a raise. We were forehead to forehead, and he said, you know, what kind of a name is Terry Sue for you? You're from the North. It's such a diminutive. The Barbies become Barbras, and the Maddies become Madelines, and the Terrys remain Terry. Also, my class was named Terry Culp. My godfather's collie was named Terry, and I would soon live in France. And of course, Terry is a man's name. So he said, "What else were you called?" And I said, "Well, I was called Tovah in Sunday school." And I remembered, as I tell you that line, I didn't even say Tovah in Hebrew school, because I was in Hebrew school. I went 8 hours a week.
Right.
Tuesday, Thursday, 4 to 6, and Sundays, 9 to 1, and was one of the few kids in my school, certainly the only girl who did that.
No, but was it part of that erasure that a lot of Jewish families go to not to sound too Jewish, or as you referred to in the book, JWP, Jews Who Can Pass?
Yes. It was the 50s, and I was born in the 50s, and my God, you you were patriotic. I pledge allegiance to the flag. Every morning, the Rosenbergs were about to be fried. My father got his Blazers at Brooks Brothers. There were no Volkswagens or Toyotas in Scarsdale, no Japanese or German products. We just come after the war. My father was in the intelligence because he was fluent in German. He was American, but his parents were German and Austrian. And yes, it wasn't cool.
Speaking of Lily Kaplan, she also wanted to be an actor or an actress along with another family member. Do you think that on some level you wanted to fulfill their thwarted dreams?
Well, the first one who wanted to desperately be an actress was my grandma Ada, and she went to audition on the British Music Hall. And actually, this character is the jewel in my crown of my one-woman shows. I usually take Ada everywhere. She's in Tovah crossover from Broadway to Cabaret, Tovah out of her mind. Aging is optional, because God, I hope it is. She is not in the piece about Leona Helmsley, because Leona Helmsley doesn't deserve her. Anyway, Ada was desperate to be an actress, and she showed up at the Haymarket and a theater in London, and they said, Ada, show us your ankles. And she timidly showed her ankles. She was ready to sing and dance. And then they said, Ada, show us your knees. And as she says, that was the end of my theatrical career. Nobody sees my knees except Papa. And then, not so often. So that was my grandmother. My mother was the third of four girls, and she was somewhere given the message to be quiet, to be quiet. So she didn't come out of herself and think of herself as any kind of a performer till really after my father died. And she was 85 years old.
Your mother was hypercritical of you. Do you think that depressed or encouraged your ambitions as an actor?
My mother was always fixing, at least she was fixing me. I mean, my older brother, David, Dr. David Feldshuh, was an underachiever. He's a Phi Beta Kappa from Dartmouth, who would not only headed the theater at Cornell, which he is still a professor at Cornell University, but he also is a medical doctor and a Pulitzer Prize finalist. So we called him Dr. Dave. My mother called him God. So I don't know if she fixed him as much as she fixed me, but her motto was preserve and protect. Preserve and protect those you love. Now that's mine too, as a mother. But how do you do that? The way you do that, I feel, is the way my father did it for me. He empowered me. He would put in me what he hoped for me. My mother, on the other hand, was rule bound. So she was fear bound. And I think her fear factor that dominated her life was much greater for her from where she came from than where I came from.
So was she afraid that you would not be able to have a career or a living as an actor? Was that what the fear was to her?
Also, it was a craft. I remember when I said, Mommy, I'd like to go to Juilliard. She said, you're not going to a trade school. Then she said, you're going to do acting. You'll do it for the rest of your life. Now get an education. So presumably acting wasn't an education. And I was a philosophy major, so I learned to think.
Michael Langham, who you worked with at the Tyrone Guthrie Theatre, was also hypercritical and was brutal to you. Was that good for your career? Was that good for your ambition?
Well, first of all, as a young actor, it was very Trumpian, Michael Langham, because he had all the power, and yet he picked on the little people that he could hurt. If you didn't come up to his standards, he made no bones about it. He simply didn't believe in me. And I'm as you ask me this question, I see a pattern. I had a mother who was, I won't say hypercritical, but constantly correcting and fixing to preserve and protect, and a father who had gallons of unconditional love.
You also had Uta Hagen, who was like your father.
Uta Hagen taught me how to teach. Uta Hagen taught me how to coach soccer. Uta Hagen never said a lousy word to her students, her children, her kids. She would say, that's interesting. Why don't we try it this way? So when I coached soccer and they came to me and said, coach, it was a girls team, 5 to 10 year olds. Coach, I made a goal with my elbow. I said, that's so interesting. What about your foot? Should we try your foot? And that was the thing, to find another path in rather than to decimate a person.
Garson Kanin, the great director, and his wife, Ruth Gordon, who was your matron of honor, in fact, were very important in your life and friends. What did they teach you about acting that you could carry through?
Garson was the lone voice at Sardi's restaurant when he took me to lunch saying, do not leave Yentl to go into Rex for Richard Rogers. Mm-hmm. Never leave a hit. Everybody else, you know, who said, Tovah, you must leave the Yentl and all that, because between your name and all that stuff, don't you think, Gary? So she, everybody wanted me to go to Rex to play Anne Boleyn and Princess Elizabeth. It was only opposite Nicole Williams. Mm-hmm. And of course it was Richard Rogers, and I just worked for him in Rogers and Hart at the old Helen Hayes. And he said, never leave a hit. And for some reason, I listened to him. Nicole Williamson hit a chorus boy, a friend of mine.
Yeah.
As I say, we were in Rogers and Hart together. He was taken up on charges and the musical failed.
It was famous. It was a famous incident. And of course you went on to Yentl. But before we go to Yentl, I wanted to ask you about Ruth. And she said to you, Tovah, always use sex or always use your sex. What does she mean by that?
I think she means what we say in Yiddish, koyach, your the molten energy of your soul that goes through all your chakras, if you want to get Buddhist about this. So she entitled herself to her miniskirts and her razzmatazz till the day she died. As a matter of fact, at the wedding, she was matron of honor, and she wanted to cut the matron of honor dress above her knees. I said, well, you upstage me at this wedding. I'm throwing you through the windows of the plaza. So she meant to you, no matter what, even with Golda. Golda has a love affair with cigarettes and with men. Incidentally, they used to call Golda the mattress. She was an easy lay. Interesting, huh? Interesting.
Yes, she was.
She and Emma Goldman, I guess. I don't know if it was free love.
Well, we're on the subject of Golda. I was a little, I don't know if I was disappointed. I was surprised that there wasn't a lot of Golda in the book. Why is that?
Because the book is through the eyes of my mother and me. And my mother came to see me in Golda Meir probably two or three times. And as she said to me, Tovah, I rate your parts by how you look. Dolly Levi is a 10. Golda Meir, 0. And
getting back to Yentl, of course, that was your great breakthrough role, your first Tony nomination.
The reason I got Yentl, God bless Michael Fairchild, I changed my name back to its Hebrew root. So my perceived value changed. In New York, you know, Shakespeare says, what's in a name, Patrick? Everything's in a name, because your life is not about my life. Your life is about the wonderful things you are doing. So a name is a very quick way of putting people in a slot. So I was perceived probably Orthodox, foreign, Israeli, and erudite in the Jewish religion.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kidding me? I was a cheerleader from Quaker Ridge School. So I was a very good student. I got Yentl because I thought I'd be great at it. And I dived into research and I made it work. It was a little girl changes herself to disguise as a boy so she could study the Torah. So you give an actor a lot of transformation, a huge obstacle. And if you do it well, if you do what's required, you may just get a Tony nomination.
Isaac Bashevis Singer in the New York Times, who wrote the original story of Yentl, the yeshiva boy, in the New York Times was very critical of Barbra Streisand, who adapted it into a film and very praiseworthy of you, said that you played the role perfectly. Do you think that his criticisms of Streisand and the adaptation of the film were justified?
Isaac came to the house in the few years we lived in Hollywood, and I don't know how he got to Hollywood. He'd be coming. I said, how are you, Isaac? He said, I'm very upset. I'm very upset. Barbra, she sings. Yentl don't sing. She sings on a boat. It's a mix with the funny girl. It's ridiculous. I'm so angry at myself. Why did I sell her the rights? I said, listen to me, Mr. Singer. Without Barbra Streisand, Yentl would be a Broadway show that was successful and went away. We weren't filming any Broadway shows at that time, unfortunately. God, I wish we had. I said, she has brought your work to the fore and she spent her money doing it. And it's a dedication to her father. I said, bless her, because her movie will last long after all of us. Look, I love Barbra Streisand. She's very nice to me. She sent me her album of Yentl and said, too bad Yentl didn't have songs. Too bad Yentl didn't have more songs when you were on Broadway. You would have been wonderful. She's always been generous. Her best one was, Tovah, I'm getting rid of all my chaserai. And she lived at the Ardsley across the street from me. Would you like some of my junk? I said, I'm coming with the truck. So, I have a lot of stuff, including her Donna Karan sneakers. So I said, if I wear your sneakers, will my voice get better?
You once said, or you quoted actually, the fact that it takes 20 years to learn to act and 20 years to unlearn to act. How does that apply to the process?
You want to be accurate, excellent. Here's the key, effortless. When does a part become cellular? Gold is cellular in me, of course. I've done it since 2003. And if they asked me to do it tomorrow, I would say, yes, I'd love to bring her back to New York. So you have to over-prepare to go with the flow, particularly in film and television. First, you carve a character. You figure out what the truth is, and you carve it. And then you let her float for a while. The actor wants to know everything about a character so that the character can know nothing. Golda Meir doesn't know that they're going to get a surprise attack from Egypt to Israel. Tovah knows. So you go onto the stage with the tabula rasa because you have this reservoir of accumulated knowledge about one human being. And you start to, when it feels great, kids, it feels like a Mozart cadenza. It's like you're making it up. It feels like you're Wynton Marsalis, that you're in a jazz riff and you're just making it up. It's not like you're doing the script. It's like you wrote it from a blank sheet of paper.
Mm-hmm. You've played, obviously, you played these historical characters. You played Golda Meir. You also played Ruth Bader Ginsburg twice. You mentioned in the book that you played Ruth in the first go around reverently. Is there a danger in being too reverent in one's approach, whether you're a writer or an actor, toward the character that you're playing?
It's a danger to be boring. You have to show the pockmarks of everybody's humanity to engage the house and to engage any of our interests. But I got to meet her four times before she died, and I was so lucky to research her while she was alive. My biggest penance with Ruth was that I had to walk around like this in the final scenes of the play when she had this, I guess she had spinal stenosis of some sort. But she was a remarkable person for a lady, which is what her mother told her to be. She broke through a plate glass ceiling for women. And was clearly one of the pioneers. She was a precursor to the second wave of the women's movement.
And did you think that, I think you played her in Sisters in Law, was that it? Was that a lesson?
Shapiro, which I hope will come to New York in the 2022 season. It was produced by Elizabeth Weber, Paul Cruz at the Annenberg Center for Performing Arts, and the Franzens, Dale and Don Franz.
Was that a less reverent portrayal of Ruth Bader Ginsburg than?
It was a humanist portrayal. What they did is they bounced this very brilliant intellectual Brooklyn Jew against this cowgirl named Sandra Day O'Connor, you know, who rode a horse with President Reagan and was the first woman justice in the Supreme Court and a Republican. And she was very nice to Ruth, but they had very different points of view, at least according to the book that then became the play.
At one point, you bemoan the fact that you're never going to enter the Olympics of acting, and you long to do the high jump, I suppose. What of your roles do you feel gave you that opportunity to do the high jump?
Well, the final, it wasn't a nail in a coffin, the final turning point where I began to believe in myself that I had a shot at being a great artist for the rest of my life. I don't say this with my chest puffed out. It's my dream. I'm an excellence machine. That's what drives me. That's why I turned down Three's Company. That's why I didn't take TV series early. And maybe I should have. I probably would have been better known and far more and richer. But I couldn't bear to be in projects that didn't use all of me. So the real turning point, it was Jack O'Brien and playing Juliet in Romeo and Juliet, Isabella in Measure for Measure, Marjorie Pinchwife in The Country Wife, and small parts in Two Gentlemen of Verona, and my first one-woman show, Tovah, Rush Hour Review, where he was the overseer and director. It was those heavy-duty roles, the four classics in a row within a year, a little more than a year, and I said, I think I know what I'm doing, and I'm going to change my ground of being. I'm going to assume I know what I'm doing and I'm going to relax and work toward it. We're just in negotiation now with something I can't discuss, but she's a major figure and you love her. And I'm thrilled if this goes through, if the deal goes through, that I can spend time with the character of this person. That's what was so great about doing Golda and Juliet and Ruth Bader Ginsburg. These people were amazing human beings, and I got to glean from them their knowledge. I got to imbibe their knowledge and then imbue it inside myself and then give it back to you.
Lily has great Borscht Belt humor. When you're playing 54 Below, she says, that's not a theater, that's a temperature, but I'm a bum. And my daughter's playing an igloo. Where does that tradition of Borscht Belt comedy come from? And is it born out of pain, as is often said?
You know, I can only tell you that she was probably funny her whole life, and the jokes didn't emerge fully till after Dad passed away on May 11th, 1996. The desire to laugh, to choose laughter over tears, is a very clever one and a good one. And the ironic humor, like I have very small bosoms, and my daughter and my mother were size C. So Amanda was getting off the plane from La Coruña, Spain, my wonderful daughter, Amanda, forgive me. And she's coming off the plane, and my mother's there in her bra. And my mother says, she looks at Amanda, she looks at me, she looks at herself, she says, wow, I guess it skips a generation. So she was hilarious, just hilarious, and was great at the put down. After all, at Amanda's bat mitzvah, she asked Amanda if she was open for business. She thought that her dress was very suggestive. Fortunately, my daughter didn't pick up what was going on. And then Brandon, my wonderful son, Garson Brandon Levy, when he went to visit my mother after my father's death, she said, Brandon, she was already 100. Brandon, I haven't kissed a man in 15 years since Grampy died. When you go today, I want you to kiss me on the lips. You got that? On my lips. And my sweet son, my sweet teenage son, leaned down and kissed his grandmother smack on her lips.
Were you able to translate this tradition of humor when you played that outrageously funny, wild Maria in Lend Me a Tenor, the wife of...
Yes, I love that kind of stuff. Maria Morelli and Where's the Bathroom from Naomi Bunch on Crazy Ex-Girlfriend are very similar. You know, where's the bathroom? Where's the bathroom? We might need to find the bathroom. It's farce. You make rapier changes without transition, you know.
So you're able to do that in that comic timing that is so crucial to comedy. Yeah. I wanted to ask you, as we're about to wrap up, unfortunately, the statutes of limitations of the crimes that you enumerate about Lily. When did the statutes of limitations run out? When do the statutes of limitations run out when we hold our parents against things?
When I was 40 years old, my mother said, how much longer are you going to blame me? And I said, not another moment. And 7 years later, my father would die. And I just dedicated myself, no matter how tough it was, no matter how many times she told me to stand up straight and straighten myself. And you know what? About the standing up straight, she was absolutely right. But once Daddy died, I was on a holy grail to keep my mother alive.
Yeah. And she lived to 104, did she not?
She lived to 103 and 3 months.
And 3 months.
I want to live to 104, Patrick. Well, that's what I want to do.
It sounds like you will. Last question. You're in the park, I believe. In the book, you're in the park, and somebody comes up to you and says, Tova, where have you been? Are you retired? We miss you on the stage. You think an expletive, but you say to her, this is my greatest role. And you're referring to the children, I think, that are in the stroller and you're carrying or whatever. Tell us a little bit about that moment. And did you feel, gosh, people are forgetting who I am?
No, Patrick, I didn't. You know, I've been married 44 years to a wonderful man. And these are Lily's values, that you stay on the field of play for a marriage. You don't leave the field of play. Margaret Mead said, you marry one man several different ways, you marry several men the same way, just keep scalloping. I wasn't afraid of disappearing. In my family, if you can't bring up your children, go like this, you're a flea, you're nothing. And I think marriage is the biggest accomplishment I've ever done in my life. It is a constantly moving, it's this fluid river of adjustments, and it benefits the children, and the children come first. I think children make us heroic. And you can ask other actors who are experts in empathy. That's how we make a living. They're usually pretty darn good parents, particularly if they can stay together with their mate, pretty darn good parents, because it's easy to, you want to preserve and protect the young, but you know, if you're Laura Benanti's child, it's very different than being Lily Feldshuh's child. You know, I had a much tougher go of it. On the other hand, pushing up against this problem for the primary years of my life. So when I got Langham and other people who didn't believe in me, it was a familiar earlier experience. And I didn't flag. I didn't give up. I felt sad. I felt sad, but I didn't give up. And in terms of being forgotten, look, this is the third act of my life, and I want it to be the culmination of my life. Am I operating life with my foot on the pedal? Yes. I wrote a memoir. We're turning it into a television series. I'm in negotiation to do another very famous person in a one-woman format, but it's a great one. And I'm hoping RBG will come in. So I'm ready to rock and roll with my beloved hometown, New York City, and get back on the stage and keep doing film and television.
And we will look forward to that, to all of it. As you said to Brandon, under promise and over deliver. And that is what you've done for all your life. Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure, Patrick. Great to see you.
Great to see you. And thank you for joining us. We'll be back next month with another look at the expert and singular creatives who live and work only to astonish us. I'm Patrick Pacheco.